صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله عليه وسلم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All the praise and all the glory is due to Allah, and I bear witness that there is no God worthy of being worshipped but Allah, and that Muhammad is his last prophet and messenger. My dear respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to a new episode of Pearls of Wisdom. Here we try to focus on some pieces of advices that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam directed to some of his Sahaba to shed light on the life of the Sahabi and how did he benefit from these recommendations or these advices, and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed him, and how should we actually reflect ourselves on those pieces of advice and benefit from them in our daily life. In today's session, this is a piece of advice, or it's basically seven pieces of advice which have been given from the Prophet ﷺ to Abu Dharr. And Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, as we mentioned before, he is one of the early Muslims. He accepted Islam at early stage, and one time he was one of five people on the face of the earth who were Muslims. So he represented one-fifth of Islam one day. And Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, he had, as I mentioned to you, he had a history, because before Islam, he used to work as a highway robber. So Abu Dharr al-Ghifari and the whole of his tribe used to work in that area. And he had a situation with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I mentioned to you before, when he called names for Bilal, and how he corrected that, and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam handled this issue. But in today's session, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari is saying, "Qala amarani khalili bi sab'in." He said, "My elite friend sallallahu alaihi wasallam has commanded me to do seven things. He commanded me to love the paupers or the poor and draw myself closer to them." This is the first advice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Second advice, he commanded me to look at those who are lower than me in position, in wealth, in life, and not look after those who are better than me. Number three, وَأَمَرَنِي أَنْ أَصِلَ الرَّحِيمَ وَإِنْ أَدْبَرَتْ. And he commanded me to maintain my relations with my kith and kin, even if they run away from me. Number five, and he وَأَمَرَنِي أَلَّا أَسْأَلَ أَحَدًا شَيْئًا. And he commanded me not to ask anybody for anything. And then وَأَمَرَنِي أَنْ أَقُولَ الْحَقَّ وَلَوْ كَانَ مُرًّا. And he commanded me to speak out the truth, even if it is sour. وَأَلَّا أَخَافَ فِي اللَّهِ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. And I do not fear anybody with regard to the rights of Allah. And finally, he commanded me to repeatedly and frequently say, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. There is no barrier between me and sin, and there is no power except in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said this statement or these words are from a treasure beneath the mighty throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us actually live with those seven golden pieces of advice the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. The first piece of advice is to love the paupers. And this advice is a very golden advice. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had an experience actually when he one day, as it is mentioned in Surah Al-An'am, and when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam drew himself closer to the noble chieftains of Mecca like Abu Sufyan and those people, and he turned away from Bilal and from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and some other humble Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah revealed in this occasion the ayah in which he says, وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he doesn't actually turn away from those noble Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim. And he should not actually turn away to those chieftains at the expense of the noble Sahaba who gave him support. Getting closer to the poor has a lot of benefits. Number one, it reminds you of realizing and recognizing how great bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored on you. Number two, it trains yourself and your in actually being humble in talking and drawing yourself closer to them. Number three, when you have a communication with the poor and people who don't have that high position, my brothers and sisters, it is basically you are loving them and they love you basically for the sake of Allah. Why? Because there is nothing, there is no worldly benefit that may be expected from you or from them. So the type of relationship is pure and the type of love is actually very strong and the relationship is very strong. So the Prophet ﷺ used to live with those Sahaba. The Messenger ﷺ used to have long time with Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Abu Huraira, along with some other Sahaba, they used to live in the masjid in a place which is called As-Suffa. As-Suffa is a place which took a corner in the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ. And he used to care about those Sahaba. When the Prophet ﷺ is given food, when the Prophet ﷺ is given milk, whenever he is given anything, he shares that with them. So those people who dedicated themselves to the companionship of the Prophet ﷺ, they studied a lot of his ahadith and they conveyed a lot of knowledge for us. Basically, the Messenger ﷺ strengthened his relationship with those poor. And he commanded Abu Dharr al-Ghifari to draw himself closer to those people, because they don't have too much of this dunya, of this life. So they always remind the person of Allah. They remind a person of the hereafter. They remind the person of acts of charity. Instead of talking, you know, when you sit with a rich person, has a lot of projects, what type of conversation and what type of talks that he is going to have with you? Most of his talks is about this piece of land, this sum of money, this bank account, these monies, dollars, and these health and wealth, and how did he go and how did he handle his life. So it actually does not remind the person. It's a statement of ghafla or oblivion. So this is why the Prophet ﷺ commands Abu Dharr al-Ghifari to be well with, or to stay well with, the masakin or the paupers. The second advice is so precious. And it is most of the people, they have problems in their lives because they don't implement this piece of advice. This is especially for wives and husbands, actually. Everybody puts himself in the, he always underestimate the bounties that Allah has given to him. So everybody is looking after improvements, is looking after other people. Everybody is expecting more wealth, is expecting more lands, more business, increase in the vanities of this life. So the Prophet ﷺ instructed Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, when you look at people, when you compare yourself to people who don't have, those bounties. So you will overestimate the bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to you. Like, for example, when somebody is, you know, when you go to somebody and subhanAllah, he is poor, he doesn't have money, he doesn't have, he has, yani for example, if you have a disease, or if you feel sick for some time, you can go to the hospital and to see how people are suffering. You can imagine if, alhamdulillah, you have less fortune, you are less fortunate with regard to your wealth, but if you go to hospital, a person who suffers from diabetes, a person who has actually to spend 4 or 5 hours a day to clean his kidney or to conduct or under a surgery, or a person who is blind, a person who has cancer, a person who has an incurable disease. Subhanallah, when you look at those people who have trials, tribulations, being tested from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will definitely overestimate and you will appreciate how grateful Allah to you is. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving you a lot of bounties and you do not basically pay them back. You don't pay anything back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you don't even estimate what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to you. This is the reason that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded me to look at those who are lower than me, and he prohibited me from looking. And in here, looking, it's actually, you can look at people who are better than you in knowledge, in acts of ibadah, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the authentic hadith, that there is no envy except in two things. And envy here in its positive way, which means that there are only two things that a person may actually wish to have that they are actually in his brothers or in other people. Those two bounties are, the Prophet ﷺ says, لَا حَسَدَ إِلَّا فِي سْنَتَيْنِ. There is no envy except in two things. Number one, in the case of a person who has been given knowledge, so he acts according to this knowledge. Or he is given the Quran, so he spends day and night reciting the Quran. And the second person is a person who is given wealth, and he spends it by day and night in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are required to look at those people who are better than us in those two basic fields. But otherwise, in health and wealth, in other things, you will definitely underestimate the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These, my brothers, are three of the seven advices that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. We will have a short break, and afterwards we'll return back explaining more of the seven golden pieces of advices. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His mercy upon all of us. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته, and welcome back to the seven golden advices that the Prophet ﷺ has given to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. Again, the Prophet ﷺ commanded me, as Abu Dharr al-Ghifari reports, to love the poopers and to draw myself closer to them. He commanded me to look at those who are lower than me, and I don't look at those who are better than me. And number three, he commanded me to maintain the relationship of my kith and kin. Here it is a very important advice. The Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يُبْسَطَ لَهُ فِي رِزْقِهِ وَيُنْسَأَ لَهُ فِي عُمُرِهِ فَلْيَصِرْ رَحِمَهُ. Whoever would like an increase in his provisions and a blessing in his time, he should maintain his relations to his kith and kin. And this is very important advice, especially my brothers and sisters, that we have a disappearance, we have a lot of problems. We do not pay attention to the importance of the kith and the kin, the rights of the kith and kin. Most of the people, they think that having good relations with your relatives, with your brothers, sisters, etc., is actually a matter of exchanging greetings, exchanging phone calls, doing this and that. But some people, they look at maintaining the relations with kith and kin as if they must actually exchange greetings with you. They have to call me in order to call them. They have to give me respect in order to give them respect. Here in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Dharr was commanded, and all of us for sure were commanded, to maintain our relations with our kith and kin, even if they run away from you. And the Prophet ﷺ received a complaint from someone, and I think this happens for a lot of people. A man came to the Messenger ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have some relatives. I maintain my relations with them, but they don't pay attention to me. They try to dissever their relations with me. They cut me off. They don't talk to me. They don't call me. So the Prophet ﷺ said, كَأَنَّكَ, when you are doing this, you are just like throwing hot dust or ashes in their mouths. So as if you are basically harming them. You are basically punishing them if you do this. But you continue. And he said, the Prophet ﷺ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still giving you support and help as long as you regularly and frequently continue maintaining your relations with them. My brothers and sisters, this is a very important advice nowadays. In a world in which everybody is busy with himself, keep himself away from his, he has a lot of distractions, we don't have time for our relatives, for our kith and kin, the Prophet ﷺ commanding and emphasizing the importance. That's why the Prophet ﷺ reported for us how ar-Rahim. And you see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ said, ar-Rahim shajnatun min ar-Rahman. The word Rahim, what is ar-Rahim? Ar-Rahim, it refers to the womb. And this is the place where the person lives his early days and his 9 months in the stomach of his mother, the womb. It's called ar-Rahim. And ar-Rahim refers to the relationship of the kith and kin. And it is derived from ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman is the compassionate and the merciful. Ar-Rahimu shajnatun min ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahim, the relationship of the kith and kin, is derived from ar-Rahman, the most merciful and the compassionate, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined and commanded that the mercy is connected and is given to the one who maintains the good relations with the kith and kin. And then in the Day of Judgment, the Prophet ﷺ portrayed to us how ar-Rahim comes in front of Allah, and it is given like the form or the image of a person standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and complaining to him. Qamat ar-Rahim, the Rahim stood up in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and started to complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying, Ya Rasul, Ya Allah, I have been dissevered. All the ties of relations have been dissevered in this life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and gave her the promise that I'm going to connect whoever connects you with me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that to die the connection between ar-Rahim and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mercy is fall for people who connect and maintain their relations with their kith and kin. So my brothers and sisters, the fourth advice the Prophet ﷺ has given to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari is very strong. And it affected basically the life of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. When at the time of Uthman ibn Affan, he found some of his friends and some of his companions were turning to reap the vanities of this life. So Abu Dharr al-Ghifari used to speak out the truth. And this is the implementation of the command or the advice the Prophet ﷺ has given to him. وَأَمَرَنِي أَنْ أَقُولَ الْحَقَّ وَلَوْ كَانَ مُرَّا. He, the Prophet ﷺ, commanded me to speak out the truth, even if it is sour. In a lot of situations, a lot of people become shy to speak the truth. You feel shy to give an advice for somebody else. You feel shy to correct the path of somebody. Enjoining good and forbidding evil. People don't try to join good and forbid evil out of fear that it may actually bring up the wrath and anger of their peer or their friends or their beloved ones. But the Prophet ﷺ said, speak out the truth. But there is a very important here, there is a very important point. When you enjoin good, you must actually enjoin this good in a good way. And when you forbid evil, it's very important to remember that this evil that you prohibit or you disjoin is actually must not bring up another greater harm or another greater evil for the people that you admonish or that you give advice. So the Prophet ﷺ compared people who speak the truth to Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib in the authentic hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, Sayyidu shuhada'i Hamza, the master of martyrs is Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. And a man who stood up in front of a tyrannical ruler and he started commanding him with good and forbid him with evil, to forbid him from evil. So he stood up and he killed him. Such a person who speaks out the truth, he is compared to the master of the martyrs, Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Abu Dharr also said, and the Prophet ﷺ commanded me not to fear anybody. When I speak the truth, we should not fear anybody. Make sure, my brothers and sisters, that when you speak the truth, nobody could harm you. Nobody can harm you with something that Allah has in destined for you. And this is directing our hearts of fear. And fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a great act of worship. It is basically one of the basic elements of a person's belief, to fear Allah alone. You remember when the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim in the battle of Uhud, and they found out all the armies surrounding them from everywhere. And it has been said to them, إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ, people have gathered together to harm you and to take you off, to smite your necks all. So, قَالُوا, what is the response of the believers when the shaitan informed them that إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ, he said, so fear them. And they said, they responded back by saying, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ, sufficient is Allah for us. He is our helper and supporter, and He is the best wakil that who covers all of our affairs. And the final advice, or the seventh advice that the Prophet ﷺ has given to Abu Dharr was, and he repeatedly was admonished by the Prophet ﷺ to say this statement. It is, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. What is the meaning of la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah? It is a declaration that you declare before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that there is no power, there is no strength, and there is no barrier between you and any harm or between you and sin, except it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a person declares that he is innocent of his own power, of his own strength, of his own knowledge, because many of the people, they become proud of themselves, proud of their work, proud of their endeavors, thinking that they have been given that great wealth, that great health, these great bounties for granted because of themselves, because of their knowledge, as Qarun said. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to say this statement and to make it as a principle which is planted in our own hearts. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. There is no power, there is no strength, there is no barrier between me and sin except in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers, these are the seven golden advices that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delivered to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, and they are all reminders for all of us to implement and to take them as a complete way of life. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower all his benefits from all the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.